Hi, so I'm Dr. Amit Sanghvi. I'm an interventional cardiologist practicing in Mumbai. Today we are here to discuss about the role of vaccination in patients who are suffering from chronic heart failure. And for this discussion, we have two eminent cardiologists from India with us. We have Dr. Samir Dani, who from Ahmedabad, who's head of the Department of Cardiology in UN Mehta Institute of Health Sciences. And we have Dr. Sundeep Mishra, who is the professor of cardiology in AIMS. So we have two eminent cardiologists from India, and we are going to discuss about role of vaccination in patients of heart failure. How should we use this in these patients of heart failure, and what can we do more to promote more and more patients from getting these vaccinations. So I think I'll start first with Dr. Dani, sir. So I'd like to ask you, sir, what do you think, how important is the use of these to use vaccination in patients of chronic heart failure, because most of these patients are quite sick, they have recurrent hospitalizations. So what do you think, how important it is?
Yeah, I think try to subdivide the whole thing and tell most important thing is that patients with chronic heart failure, they are at higher risk of developing pneumonia and lung infections. That is one aspect of it. And second aspect is that once they do develop pneumonia or lung infections, they are at a higher risk of developing more cardiac events or acute cardiac events. So it's a double-edged sword.
Yeah.
And they are at a higher risk for acquiring the pneumonia and higher risk for acute cardiac events once they acquire pneumonia. And we have seen that the vaccination seems to work very well. And though these patients are, as you rightly said, very sick, they do benefit from it. We have a number of studies to prove that. And these vaccinations are pretty safe in today's scenario.
So the second question is for Dr. Mishra, sir. So do we have, like sir said that, vaccinations are generally safe, they're easily available, so we should use in these patients. But do we have any data to support use of vaccinations in these patients? Because when we look at cardiology, interventional cardiology, we look at hard endpoint data of mortality benefits, hospitalizations, and decreased MACE. So do we have such strong data for the use of vaccinations in this class of patients?
So we have data actually. Now data is basically from chronic heart disease patients. Of course, heart failure is one of the most serious type of chronic heart disease. And the data, as Dr. Dani already told us, shows that the people who suffer from heart disease, they are predisposed to developing infections. And once they develop these infections, then they are even prone to develop more complications. So as he said, there are two things. Number one, people of heart disease are more likely to develop infections. So that is one. So they can cause more infections. But once they develop infections, they are more likely to have complications. Particularly in context of heart failure, they have more likely to have recurrence of decompensated heart failure. So there is a lot of data. There is data to say that mortality is higher in people who develop pneumonia with chronic heart disease, particularly heart failure. And there is data of vaccination showing that some types of vaccinations can actually bring down these event rates and recurrences. But there is no randomized control trial. So I think that is...
I think what we have is more of observational studies from USA and Denmark, which have shown that, they'll decrease hospitalizations as well as probably some benefits in mortality.
Right.
Probably there is a big study going on, the VAC-HEFT study, which might later on show us that probably we'll get, then it might come as class 1 or 2 recommendation in the ESC-ACC guidelines probably at that time. So Dr. Dani sir, so which vaccines are recommended routinely in this class of patients and what is the schedule? How do we generally go about doing this immunization in these patients?
Yeah, I think, most important as we discussed are the lung infections, influenza and pneumonia. And so the important vaccines, most important vaccines for prevention in these class of patients, chronic heart failure patients, are the pneumococcal vaccines and the influenza vaccines, the flu virus vaccines. So those two are the most important ones. The viral vaccines, antiviral vaccines are recommended once a year. We will discuss that in later as you we progress in the questions. And the pneumococcal vaccines are usually once in 5 years, depending on what vaccine you are using.
Yeah. Right. So you have two vaccines generally, Prevnar and you have the Pneumovac 23. So generally, both of them are generally given at 1 yearly interval. Right. And once, unless anyone, there are some coexisting comorbid conditions where probably you'd like to use it a little more often in this patients. So, Dr. Mishra sir, how do these vaccines act? Is it only that they prevent lung infections and that is the only way that they act, or do they have some other benefits also? I mean, is it only preventing lung infections, or also do they act on the molecular level? Prevent release of cytokines, and that's at some point of time may prevent the patient from progressing. If say a patient who has a moderate heart function, it might prevent it from progressing into severely decompensated cardiac failure and what we call as heart failure with reduced ejection fraction.
So as you rightly said, it is rather complex, the whole mechanism. The thing is that if these people developed both flu and pneumococcus, and actually as a matter of fact there are three or four other vaccinations that are possibly useful. One of them is zoster, varicella zoster vaccination, which could be given in elderly age group of patients, or human papillomavirus, and things like that. So there are few other vaccines that are also found useful in certain situations. But the reality is that these vaccinations, the virus infections and the pneumococcal bacteremia, what they do is they have two effects. One is direct cytotoxic effect on the myocardium.
On the myocytes.
And so that is what they can do. And then the others are the other effects that can also happen. So vaccinations are able to take care of, act at multiple levels and take care of these phenomena. And, as you said, some other mechanism also which indirectly lead to reduction of events.
Yes. In fact, I think in US they are doing, there's this lady who's doing a lot of study on immunology, and she's been able to find out which T cells are causing this, and probably now they are looking at monoclonal antibodies. So we might have something like in chronic patients like rheumatoid arthritis and SLE patients, where we use biological agents. Maybe in the future we might have something to prevent patients from going into heart failure who are susceptible to this this infection.
So if you look at the influenza vaccine, there are basically two types, A and B, and among the A there are two types, basically H1N1, which is swine flu, and the other one is H3N2. And for B there are two types again, one of them is a Yamagata type and the other is, but the interesting part is that if you give vaccine against one particular virus, it is also effective against some other viruses. So it is not only that particular thing that will be it would be useful, but it could be useful in broad range of infectious situations where it might be useful. So as you said, they have a pleiotropic effect also.
And the most important, or probably the it will revolutionize our thinking if that happens, that you have a vaccine which prevents the progression of heart failure.
Right. That would be, probably that's like our holy grail. Probably at some point
of time. That is where we are moving, really.
We will probably reach there at some point of time. So, Dr. Dani sir, we've seen this, that, you have influenza vaccine and you have vaccines against pneumococcal, which are of two types and which we routinely use in patients, which are supposed to use in patients of heart failure. But most of these are given beyond 65 years of age initially, and unless anyone, the patient has certain other comorbid conditions. But can these vaccines also be used in immunocompromised patients? Because now we are in this era of medicine where we have so many patients who have, retroviral disease, who come to us with hematological malignancies, Hodgkin's, non-Hodgkin's lymphomas, we have so many blood dyscrasias. We all interventional cardiologists, during our career, we always see this kind of patients. Now we are seeing them more and more often, especially patients who are renal failure, on dialysis. So they are supposed to be extremely immunocompromised, and these are the patients who might require these vaccines earlier probably. So, can we use them in this patients also safely? Should we start them earlier, probably at an earlier age? Because when we find so many immunocompromised patients, then, probably we can start them early and probably give them more benefit, in which case we might have to use those booster doses of pneumovax as it is recommended.
Right. So I think you're very right. Initially, we used to think that these vaccines are very harmful. Important only in extremes of ages where susceptibility to infections is much more. And these vaccines are probably harmful in those patients who are immunocompromised or especially terminal renal failure and patients on dialysis, where you would be very careful in giving the vaccinations. But now we know that there is a data pointing to that in, even in these immunocompromised patients, these vaccines can be useful. But the most important point is, as you said, in starting early. So yes. Now we have recommendations that the patients who are even less than 65 year old, we should start them early. And once they are exposed to either conjugate or the polysaccharide based vaccines, and then you give them booster dose after a certain period of time. So I think as our understanding of these vaccination grows, our experience with them grows, and the understanding of the mechanism grows, we are going to start earlier, and the application is going to be more broad-based across the population, irrespective of age. And in fact, WHO is certainly moving towards that. Yes.
And I think also when we have this, you know, really sick patients who are immunocompromised and we need to vaccinate them, probably we don't really wait for a year like we do. When we use Pneumovax and we use Prevnar, we generally wait for a year. So in these patients, probably they say that you should also, you know, give it at the period of, say, 2 months. So you give it at 2 months because you need maximum protection early. And unlikely that these vaccines are really going to cross-act so much with each other that we may not get benefits. So probably we should, you know, give it early also in some patients, probably not all, but in some.
But basically, you know, we you know, as you said, initially it was thought that immunocompromised are to be avoided. Now we know that we have to be actually more aggressive. And we have to give it at a shorter interval, as you said, 8 weeks interval between PCV and you know, pneumovax. Yeah. And also, you know, we have to give booster doses, so we have to be more aggressive and shorter duration.
So the next question is actually for both of you, because do you think that all heart failure patients that come to us in our clinic should be routinely vaccinated at least against these two? You know, we should give them a Fluvac or for influenza, and we should give them Prevnar and Pneumovax for. So all patients of heart failure, when they come to us, should we consider them for routine vaccinations? Of course, I mean, depending upon whether the patient is immunocompromised or not, we can decide whether we want to start early or we want to wait till 65 years of age and then give them. But should all these patients give? Because if you look at the data worldwide, you know, even in countries where prevention, you know, I mean, there's a lot of thoughts about epidemiological studies and all, the vaccination extent is only between 16 to 54%. So it's not more than like 55-60%. So should we become more aggressive in, you know, trying to do this in our patients?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah. Actually, as a matter of fact, the benefit is there in all the chronic heart disease patients, looks like, particularly heart failure, then I think. And then in them, of course, if they are elderly, they are more than 65 years of age, then certainly it makes even more sense. It does not mean that less than 65 you don't get. It is even more effective. Or if they are immunocompromised for some reason, HIV, then it makes even more sense. But it has to be given possibly with our current understanding in all patients of,
especially because we generally live in overcrowded situations, the chances of cross infection is very high. So maybe we should kind of recommend for all our patients.
One is exposure, but even otherwise. And when we look at these things, any of these treatments or preventive treatments, we look at risk-benefit ratio. And here, the risk is pretty low.
Minimal, yeah.
So far, the side effects or the adverse reactions reported with these vaccines is so low that even in low-risk population, like heart failure patients with less than 65 years of age, you are talking about cumulative risk over next 20 years, which is going to be fairly high, and you have a treatment which is fairly safe, then you tend to give it to all of these patients. So I think we are moving. I mean, you can argue that there is no not enough data to support broad recommendation that everybody should be vaccinated, or everybody with heart failure should be vaccinated. But I think we are certainly moving towards that. And in my practice, I would think like that.
So so we have so many patients who come to us in our government hospitals. You know, the patients are not really very, very affording. The cost is an issue, of course. I mean, like you just suggested, that it's actually a cost-effective therapy, because if you kind of vaccinate these patients, then the chances of infection is less, hospitalization is less. So in the long run, probably it is much more cost-effective to use this therapy. But is there some way, or we can do something more by which we can incorporate into this into our government hospital? Like, sir, you work in AIMS and you worked in UN Medical. So, you know, I mean, not all patients that come to us are really affording for those 3,000-5,000 rupees also, and especially immunocompromised patients on dialysis, a lot of money going there. So, I mean, can we do something so that, you know, can we have something like a multi-dose vials which are available, say, for hepatitis B vaccine, which was not available before, now we have. So, can we have something like that, or some other thing that we can do to cut down the cost so that this is, you know, more reachable to a general population?
I think, you know, we live in a practically socialist kind of environment, especially, you know, for healthcare and at least education. So I believe that there is a role of, because considering the cost involved, which is not much actually, as a matter of fact, you know, these things, you know, for if you talk of a decade earlier or more than two decades back, then it was a big cost. Nowadays, you know, most medications are like this. Flu vaccines would cost around 600, 700 per year, and this one is like once in 5 years, even 3,000-4,000. It doesn't, I think, really doesn't matter, because the benefits that are accrued with PMJ scheme there, you know, we get money in tune of 1 lakh, 2 lakh for, you know, treatment. So I think it is a good idea to prevent. Just spend 4,000-4,000 and prevent them is much more, you know, reasonable, I think. And so I think we should be moving in this particular direction, and should be included in, you know, immunization schedule of the.
I think it has come for the children now, but
absolutely. And for the matter of just putting the record straight, I work in entirely private environment now, but. If you look, as he said, if you look at the other treatment for heart failure, you have, say, sacubitril valsartan, which is fairly heavily priced. You have, you know, modern therapies like CRTD. Or so these are really therapies which are, though very beneficial, out of bounds for our middle-class, even middle-class patients or lower middle-class patients, certainly. Forget poorer class. So once we have more data that what is the difference that these vaccines make in terms of survival benefit or morbidity benefit, once we have the data to compare, probably we will have a better perspective. But as Dr. Mishra said very rightly, the cost of this treatment is not that high. So I think we should wholeheartedly embrace it, and with all these schemes, as he again, I agree totally with the word socialist environment for healthcare, with all these schemes and this Jan Aushadhi Bhandar and PMJ, and almost every regional government or state government have their own schemes. So I think the cost of these vaccinations can be very well integrated into the overall treatment of heart failure and help our patients.
So I mean it's like a lot of times the first contact of these patients are the general physicians, general practitioners, and like we said, like you said, sir, that we don't really have that data still, not from the world, neither from India. So can we as cardiologists who are practicing day to day, you know, do something more, education of these general physicians, the physicians, should the Cardiology Society of India, because we do send data for interventions that we perform in the NIC registry, so should it have another column for vaccinations in heart failure when we are talking about heart failure. So maybe we can get more data, you know, and maybe we can probably take the lead that, okay, we have this kind of patients and this is what has happened and this is, so is there some, you know, probably can yeah, we do some?
It's a excellent idea. I mean, as CSI already has a trial going on for heart failure and you know they have they're running a registry, so this can easily be incorporated.
Just like
so easy to do, any general physician who is taking care of the patient can do this. Yeah. So
but I think it's more of a awareness issue.
Exactly.
Less of a cost issue, more of an awareness issue. Once you make people aware that okay, this really helps, or at least so far whatever data we have shows that there could be a good benefit. So I think it's more of an awareness thing, and even amongst these general physicians. So somehow this particular thing has to be spread that this is a low cost thing with minimal side effects with a possible good benefit. And in context of total heart failure therapy, you know, this will be a fraction of cost. So it's I would say it's a matter of awareness. Rather than
absolutely. And you know, somehow the cost of the therapy is related proportionate to the degree of awareness.
Yeah,
you have more costly therapy, more people are aware of it. You have something very very low cost, nobody is interested in really making it percolate down.
So
the level
there could be one, this could be one reason why it is not so, you know.
So I think just some concluding statements from both of you, a couple of lines for the listeners that about what should be the take home message for as far as vaccinations in this extremely sick patients is concerned. So, and
I would say that, you know, as we discussed, this is something which is relatively low cost. I would actually call it relatively low cost, which has got minimal side effects, but which has huge possible benefits. So I would say that, you know, people are moving towards universal immunization and moving towards giving influenza vaccine for all, giving pneumococcal vaccine for all. Here we are saying that at least for heart failure patients, they should be getting. And of course, we will be, you know, we'll wait for some more data.
I absolutely agree, and I echo the same sentiments. And vaccination is a very simple and useful tool for our heart failure patients, and every heart failure patient should get it, in fact.
So I think, I mean, concluding this session, it's very clear that prevention is better than cure, and heart failure, the most important problem with heart failure is recurrent hospitalizations. 50% of the patients, even on optimal medical therapy, will get hospitalized in the next 5 years. And if there is a very cost-effective, simple method to prevent infections, which is one